I am going to announce, and I think it will be sent out imminently or probably just now, that I'll be stepping down as CEO at the end of September, and as chairman, and I'll retire from the firm at the end of the year. That comes as a great shock to everybody given the recent press. But as I hear myself say that, because I don't think I've said that out loud yet, I'm gonna pause and let it sink in. Not so much to you, but to me. By the way, I'm not going to another bank. Because I know every time somebody, by the way, and I took off my coat too, because every time somebody comes into my office and is wearing their coat, I'm going, oh my God, where are you going? Say also that I'm also very pleased, this will be a shock and coming out of nowhere, that David Solomon will be succeeding me in both of the roles that I currently occupy. I'd say I always knew that the day would come, but again, the reality prompts a lot of thoughts and emotions, and being the history guy that I am, I tend to reflect upon these things. In fact, I was reflecting on this from the moment I got my job. Much as the press was speculating on when I was going to leave my job from the moment I got my job a little over 12 years ago. I'm always asked, I get asked in the context when I was get asked, what are your plans for succession? But even now, and as I stand here and report it, I get asked, what about the timing? Why are you doing this? And I always responded, and it just is absolutely right. This is how, when things are going badly in the firm, or the environment is challenging, and it's tough, I could never contemplate leaving. You can't leave. And when the times are better, believe me, you don't want to leave, because things are going well and it's exciting and you're pumped up and you don't want to, and it's very hard to get out. And I've always joked that my most recent predecessors had the benefit of attractive offers from government, which we'll see what comes over the transom. But I'd say, as I stand here now, I'm not dying to leave. I'm feeling good. I love, obviously I love the firm. I'm energetic. I'm excited about the prospects of the firm. It feels like a good moment in the firm. And kind of in a weird way, in this improving time when I'm optimistic, and I think Heather quite captured it, in a weird way, it kind of makes it the right time to go, because things are good and the runway is clear and we have a great performance and we have a, I personally feel that I have a great successor. And I think, I want to go and reiterate some of those points of view now that you heard a little bit from Marty, and take a, perspective on our businesses. I feel, categorize these things. Our investment banking business really has never been stronger, and really has gotten stronger over these years. The mythology that we were always this great, it wasn't really that true. I've been here for, quite a long time, and we, jousted in trading positions back and forth, but the constancy with which we're number one in all the important investment banking metrics, never took it for granted. If in between a quarter, intra-quarter, we slipped to number two, the people in that division are just hysterical about recovering their position. They don't take it for granted either. Obviously in the classic M&A, but when we turned on the jets for our origination business on the on the debt side, we also moved up the leaderboard in that stuff as on the debt side of the business as well. Investment management. And in some ways, I still, has done great, and is, really a great growth story. And I really believe IMD is really an underappreciated part of the firm. I know every part of the firm is an underappreciated part of the firm, and every individual is underappreciated. But I think that's the market doesn't realize that, how that division has grown, what a big part of the firm it is today, and really what the prospects are, and how it's grown in a market that's generally not favorable to accreting assets in an active, you know, an active managed platform. We're just seeing the results of solid performance and commitment to a broad array of products. In equities and FIC, gosh, you know, you can't pick up a report of us without reading about, you know, the scrutiny in which they're under. I've already said in the context of this market, it's been a difficult time for some of the trading businesses that rely on clients, you know, paying us to take over and transmit risk. Obviously, the regulatory environment has, and adapting to the regulatory environment over these last few years has been hard. But again, the last two quarters demonstrated the earnings power. It's still a huge part of the firm, and how well we could do in a better environment and not a fantastically better environment. And I give a lot of credit to the people in that business who really had stayed the course and labored under a very high degree of difficulty. You know, I'd like to also say something about our investing businesses. You know, the Merchant Bank and SSG, which are franchise businesses. Not everybody appreciates this, but we come in every day and we are not on the equal footing with, you know, somebody else or some other firm with just money. This is a real franchise business with a, you know, with a, you know, a good cadre of investors who've done this for a long time with great reputations, and the firm has a great reputation. It's a core part of the DNA of our firm. Not just because they are with the firm, but the firm, it's important to the firm that this is an important part of the DNA, because it's one thing to be an advisor, to do a good job for your client, to be an agent, but there's also something very powerful about having the capability, the cash, and the expertise to be a principal, to be peer-like to your clients who are also putting their money on the line, to be a co-investor, and it's a major source of influence for Goldman Sachs in the world that we are able to do this, and a very, very important part of really who we are. I always said, you know, we don't just have an investment bank, we are, you know, we don't just have a merchant bank, we are a merchant bank. And that's just a very important part of who we are. The initiatives that we have on Marcus and the digital stuff, I just want to be clear. This is real and it's important. You know, and again, I'm not going to go over and pound this about why, you know, our unique position as the potential disruptor to be both a bank and a consumer bank and a licensed deposit taker and have the wherewithal to do this and to be unburdened by legacy assets in this space and to be free to do it, to be both a disruptor and to be the kind of an institution that has a reputation and the opportunity in this space. You know, we are gung-ho on this. We have great people on this. And I just, you know, people are every time somebody says, like Heather did, gee, we don't get credit for this, we don't get credit for that, I'm patient. You know, it's right or it's wrong, we'll see it. I believe it's right. And I'm always good. Now I'm walking through the lobby of 200 West Street and I see those ads and, you know, Clarity. I ran into Adam this morning, Clarity Money, and what a, you know, how important it is to the firm. It's a very, very important part of our evolution. And I would say that ability to do Marcus is fed by and also feeds our commitment to technology and engineering and technologists and engineers. You know, it's very important. You know, historically, we were the architect and the originator behind many of the platforms that drive the wholesale part of the market. This is, you know, something that plays into our core skill set. And the excitement around being a disruptor in our very institutional, otherwise establishment firm makes it, you know, we can do that. Because we have that base and that culture and that appreciation for engineering, the ability to attract it, and in turn, it helps us to attract. So that also is a virtuous circle for us. And also, I want to give a nod, and this is very important when you sit on the executive floor and everybody's, you know, everybody's trying to chip at you in every way and looking for every foot fault, and every foot fault is a crime, and every crime is a felony, every felony is a capital offense. You know, we have a great federation team, compliance, controllers, technology, legal, and others, critical during the crisis, withstood enormous pressure, and continues to distinguish themselves. Like the rest of, you know, microcosm, but like the rest of the firm, battle hardened, and better for it. I'm not telling you, I wasn't dying to go into battle, but as long as we got through it, we're better for having gone through it. And no place where that's better realized or that we get more out of than on the Federation side of the firm. Again, very few things are taken for granted, but again, I'm proud of everybody's dedication and the drive and the focus that continues to define this institution. Now, as for me, 36 years and a bit over 12 years so far in the current job, it's a long time. It's not too long, but for reasons I already told you, it's the right amount of time. As I get distance from my role, even now, people are saying, what will I remember the most? And people will always ask, what will I miss the most about the firm? And I'll tell you, it's sitting right in front of me. It's the people of Goldman Sachs. It's what our differentiating strength is. It's what gets me to the office. It's the partnership with a small p. It's the, you know, shoulder to shoulder. It's with high concentration of bright, motivated, caring, supportive people. It's the confidence in the organization and the ability, you know, the willingness to throw in. It's the strong culture, and culture, I could do an S, you know, I could talk here for an hour on what culture means, but I'll tell you one aspect of it surely is unselfish behavior. Subordinating your short, at least in the short run, because we all want to do well personally, but the realization and having the discipline to subordinate your ego to support the platform that we can then all benefit from in our personal interests. Take some discipline and, you know, frank, in appreciation and trust and confidence in the institution, and we have that. The culture of the firm allowed all of us and allows all of us to build and protect this platform that we then use for our clients, for our shareholders, and in our personal, you know, and for our, you know, our sense of self and our egos and our personal lives as well. And that's a very important thing. And even if you knew you could map it out on paper, you have to have the confidence and the trust to know that if you make that investment, it's going to pay off. And I guess after 149 years, an appreciation develops, and that doesn't spring up overnight, and you can't dictate that. You have to live it, and you have to experience it. You know, I can't remember a time when the firm benefited more from that culture than during the financial crisis, where we really distinguished that. We went into that crisis, one of the high, and profited from and performed like one of the highest risk takers going in, and we did better than anyone else coming out, really, when you look at, you know, when you look at it and driven through it, and that was by the quality of our people and the culture of the firm that got everybody committed. I remember in the financial crisis, you know, going up, you know, 85 Broad Street, coming in, you know, bowed down, walking on, you know, out of the elevator, and all this, you know, every room on the executive floor was filled with people engaged in projects that I didn't assign. And there were people who were working on the balance sheet, people were working on what our solvency was going to be at a different time, people were going about go-it-alone strategies, people were going and working on potential merger strategies if the need came up to do that, and everybody was engaged and everybody was you know, committed. I see Tim in front. I remember Tim O'Neill and Armin going over our liquidity and trying. We had no system that would tell us what our liquidity would be on a specific day, 1 week, 1 month, you know, within $5 or $10 billion, you know, in the future. We knew what our liquidity was that day, but we couldn't tell you, given the flows, the ins and the outs, what our liquidity would be in a week. Why didn't we have that? We didn't have it because we never needed it. There's a lot of things that in hindsight, oh my gosh, why didn't we have it? Well, you didn't know you needed it. And we needed it, and, you know, people worked on that. You know, Rich you know, Rich Friedman, I remember in the crisis, it was again, once again, it was a real estate crisis. You know, Rich Friedman and the merchant banking team took over really, you know, a portfolio into their group, you know, with the people who were, you know, also making good positive contributions to it of the REPIA portfolio and just own that. I never heard, gosh, we didn't put on these positions. It wasn't our stuff. You know, oh my goodness, why am I burdened with this? We did the, you know, et cetera, et cetera. They just owned it like good, again, you know, partners and, you know, representing the good, again, culture, you know, culture of the firm. You know, whenever we've had tough days, you know, could count on everybody in this room and in this building and in all our buildings around the world to help our clients bear down file solutions and work on getting better and better and subordinate their own short-term interests for the firm and the long-term realization of their personal issues. And also, I'll say, not only supporting the firm, there were times when I got a lot of personal support because, you know, I had my own health issues too, and everybody was super, super supportive during that period. And, you know, thanks to all of you for that as well. And let me tell you, reassure you, if anybody's wondering, I'm fine. And now let me say a few words about David. I'm getting carried away with myself again, as is my custom. David joined the firm in 1999. And I'll say, I knew David, because we were in a kind of peripherally friendly in a circle of friends, but didn't know him really that well. We were friends, mostly friends of friends. But I was very heavily involved in his recruitment. David was at Bear Stearns, where he had quite a lofty position. David was already, at that time in 1999, the head of investment banking and on the Bear Stearns Management Committee. I was there to help recruit him as head of leverage finance, which was at that point then a part of the financing part of fixed income. And then during the recruitment along the way, we started to get you know, cold feet because this outsider from Bear Stearns is going to come in and run such a great enterprise as our incipient, lowly ranked leverage finance business in the context of what there's, you know, Wall Street. I think Bear Stearns was bigger than ours anyway. But in the, you know, this is a long time ago. And I'm, you know, thinking, you know, we said, you know, something too risky. Let's give him a co-head. So I know you've never heard this before in any other context. So now, you know, now we're recruiting David to be, you know, who is the head of investment banking and member of the management committee at Bear Stearns, to come in and be co-head of leverage finance at Goldman Sachs. By the way, for those of you who work in leverage finance, that's a huge job. And if it's your last position at Goldman Sachs, you should be damn pleased with yourself. Now, David joined the firm, and he agreed. And after it was all over, and I'm looking around, and I'm saying, I go to David, and I said, you know, why? Why'd you join? You know, why'd you do it? And David said, and it was simple, and it was a, you know, crisp kind of a David Solomon response. You know, that if he was going to keep investing in his career like he was, he wanted it to be in the best place that would have the best payoff for himself for the long term. And that was Goldman Sachs versus any other opportunity that I saw. If he was going to take the trouble to try to rise and realize his ambition, it might as well be in our pond, or this pond, what was in both our pond. Now, in taking that job, and over the last 19 years, I think in many contexts that David has shown that he plays the long game. He's patient, deliberate, disciplined, and for the most part, mostly right, except for the few times we've disagreed. And very importantly, he's been a very great partner for all of us. I look forward to watching him lead the firm for many years to come and to benefit and contribute to all of your, benefit from your leadership and to contribute to your growth and your improvement as leaders in the firm. I want to remind, as I end, I want to remind everyone here and on the call that there's plenty of time left in this year for us to have our best year ever. I also want to say that given that I am still CEO through September, the third quarter is the most important quarter that any of us will ever see at Goldman Sachs, and I expect you to leave it all on the field and make a good contribution. And you know, again, I want to thank you all. This is still sinking in for me. I know how things go. Everybody is on as it, you know, and as it should be. But so in that spirit, I want to ask you all to join me in welcoming the next chairman and CEO of Goldman Sachs, David Solomon. I'm gonna hang out with you for a while.
You can hang out with me. I'm gonna start by saying I'm with Heather too. I'm pumped, and I'm also gonna say I kept my jacket on, but I am definitely not going to another bank. First, I just have to start. I have to start, Lloyd, by thanking you and thanking the board for selecting me to lead this great firm on the eve of our 150th anniversary. My God, this is not going to be easy. I'm usually very, very good at speaking in public. Quite frankly, as I think about the responsibilities that are in front of me, they're quite daunting, and I am humbled. I am truly humbled to have this opportunity and for the confidence that you and the board have placed in front of me. To all of you in this room, on the call, on the video, around the world, you know, I want to let you know that I am indescribably proud to work at this firm. I love Goldman Sachs, and I am incredibly committed to our future together. And I start by asking all of you everywhere around the world, I ask you for your help and your support in the years ahead. You know, the story of Goldman Sachs, in many ways, is a story of leaders. Since 1936, 9 individuals have led this firm, from Sidney Weinberg to Lloyd Blankfein. I suspect when future historians write about this period, they will talk about Lloyd as one of the most impactful and decisive leaders in the annals of Goldman Sachs. He led us through the worst financial crisis since the Great Depression. He ushered us into a more complex business environment in the aftermath of that. And he invested constantly in our people and our culture. He helped the organization evolve. He made us an industry leader with respect to inclusion. And he really invested in community service. Over the last 12 years, Lloyd's left us in an enviable position. I know I've learned an enormous amount from Lloyd, from his intellect, from his judgment, from the power of his example. And I want to start by thanking you personally for your support, your mentorship, and your friendship. It has meant and it continues to mean an enormous amount to me. On behalf of all of us, the firm, everyone around the world, everyone on this call today, I want to thank you for your leadership and all you've done for Goldman Sachs. You have put us in a position where we can seize the opportunities that we have today and capture all that will come our way in the future. Lloyd, thank you so much. Goldman Sachs has come a long way since Marcus Goldman set up shop in a single room on Pine Street in 1869. Successive leaders of the firm have pointed to something that they've felt has contributed to the longevity and impact of this organization. John Whitehead said, "It's the things that make us special." In his words, our team spirit, our culture of service, our high level of professionalism, the pride in what we do, our culture, the key to our success. Years later, Steve Friedman said that a good organization like Goldman Sachs needs great people, culture, and strategy. And a viable strategy is by far the easiest of the three to create. So we all know, all of us as leaders of this organization, that the thing that sets us apart, that differentiates us, that makes us special, as Lloyd said, is the people of Goldman Sachs and our culture. Goldman Sachs and the world have changed in unimaginable ways over the last 150 years. Somehow through it all, we've not only survived, we've thrived. In good times and bad, in booms and bust, in peacetime and war, we have succeeded because we've embraced change and anticipated it, but also at times through our innovative culture, we've created it. My job is to extend and maintain that precious legacy. When I think about the talent in this organization, the power of the franchise, the abilities of this firm, I am hugely confident about the future for all of us and look forward to all that we can accomplish together. Thank you very much. I look forward to working with each and every one of you.
All right, everybody, let's go out there and kill it for the third quarter.